£2.
Baby, in this world there's a whole lot of shame. In this world there's a whole lot of trouble and a whole lot of ground to gain. Why take when you could be given? Why watch as the world goes by? It's a long enough life to be living. Why walk when you can fly? And a heart for a pair of wings. There's a star on the far horizon, rising bright in an azure sky. For the rest of the time that you're given, why walk when you can fly high? Why walk when you can fly?
Diving right in, get ready. Growing up, I had this swing set in my backyard, and it had what I recently discovered is called a glide ride, which is essentially this basket-like thing. It could sit two people, it had a back on either side and a floor. It was my favorite part of this swing set, and I would play out there all the time. A lot of the times, I would be by myself. But even if I was by myself, I had to do this thing before I could commit to playing. So I would climb into this basket and I would push and push and push and push and push until I felt that moment right before it crested and where everything felt weightless. And for that half second, nothing else mattered, right? It was just me being held in this insane dance with physics and this feeling of flying. And then after that, I could totally start playing, but it's like if I didn't do that, then I knew it was all make-believe and I would second-guess myself. But if I, a plus-size wee babe with a predisposition for falling, could fly, if only for a moment, then it's like anything was possible. Anything was possible. And I would get into all kinds of trouble, all kinds of adventures. And when I was a girl, I had a favorite story of a meadowlark who sang with the river's wind. Her voice could match the angels in its glory, but she was blind. The lark was blind. An old king came and took her to his palace, where the walls were burnished bronze and golden braid. And he fed her fruit and nuts from an ivory chalice, and he prayed, "Sing for me, my meadowlark. Sing for me on the silver morning. Set me free, my meadowlark, and I'll buy you a priceless jewel and cloth and brocade and crewel, and I'll love you for life if you will sing for me." Then one day, as the lark sang by the water, the god of the sun heard her in his flight, and her singing moved him so he came and brought her the gift of sight. He gave her sight and he opened her eyes to the shimmer and the splendor of this beautiful young god, so proud and strong. And he called to the lark in a voice both rough and tender, "Come along, fly with me, my meadowlark. Fly with me on a silver morning past the sea where the dolphins bark. And we'll dance on the coral beaches, make a feast of the plums and peaches, just as far as your vision reaches. Fly with me." But the meadowlark said no, for the old king loved her so. She couldn't bear to wound his pride. So the god flew away, and when the king came down that day, he found his meadowlark had died. Every time I heard that part, I cried. And now I stand here starry-eyed and stormy, just when I thought my heart was finally numb, a beautiful young man appears before me, saying, "Come, oh, won't you come? And what can I do if finally for the first time the one I'm burning for returns the glow? If love has come at last, it's picked the worst time. Still I know I've got to go. Fly away, meadowlark, fly away on the sea.
Thank you.
the gate. Yeah! It had to be there. It had to be there. It's a show about flight, and I didn't want it to become this thing. Like, is it going to happen? And then you were going to be nervous, and I was going to be nervous. We had to get it out of the way. And now we can all just move on with our lives in a really exciting way. Hi! Oh my God. What a gift it is to see all of you gorgeous humans. Hi. Wow. Oh, I love every single one of you. This is such a dream. Hi. Wow, thank you for being here tonight. What is tonight? Tonight's gonna be chill, she says after Meadowlark. But it is. It is. I'm very much recovering from a back moment that happened last week. So sadly, the aerial silk routine that we had planned, we sadly had to pivot away from that. But we'll do some sensible step touches in its place. I'll do it for you, Nico. You love a step touch. I know this about you. No, we're going to have fun. We're going to have fun. Tonight is just a night full of my favorite songs in the whole world. A lot of them are songs from shows I've been a part of, are songs that have very generously been written for me over the years, songs that have been gifted to me. And I really do think that music is something that you can gift people. When someone's like, oh, I heard this song and it made me think of you, or oh, I think you should sing this song, that's such a beautiful gift to offer someone. And there's been this recurring theme in my life, in my career, with music that I get given a lot, and it's all to do with birds and flying, which is remarkable because I have a very complicated relationship with gravity. Very complicated relationship, in particular with low and high heights, mostly low heights, which we'll talk about later. But these songs just keep sort of falling at my feet, and this idea has been percolating for a very long time, and I just feel very honored to be sharing this with you tonight. And this next song, this is kind of the first song that I remember learning. It was the first song that I remember being like, oh, I should learn that. And I was like 4 at the time. But it came into my life at a time when I really needed it. And I kind of think that's the magic of this song. And I would wager that most people in this room have a similar relationship with it. It kind of transports you to this Technicolor world where things are okay for a little while. And I really needed that as a kid. So to sing this next one, I would love to introduce, making his New York City debut, my dad, Steve Bonino. Can you even handle it?
Hi, dear.
Hi.
Hey, how are you? This is my dad. It's for you. Yeah, I'll let you do that. That seems like a personal thing. Yeah. Yeah. You like flying. You don't have a complicated relationship with it. I feel like. Yeah, I have too, but you like it. I didn't know this. When? Were you okay?
15 years ago.
The things you learn on stage at Joe's Pub. Be safe. What is wrong with you?
I worked with a guy who flew helicopters and.
It was a helicopter?
It was a little Cessna.
I don't know what that means, but it was a little Cessna.
Yeah, a little teeny single engine plane. Yeah, and we got over Portland where we crapped out in the van.
Yeah.
Going to Brigadoon.
Sure.
Flew right over there. And he said, here, you want to take it?
And you survived. You were okay. Would not catch me in that Cessna, but that's fine. No, I wouldn't have loved it. What are you talking about? No, I really would not have. You're making me tip over. Jeez. Well, how you doing? You tuned?
Yeah, we're in tune.
We're in tune? I did. Well, Chris tuned it because he's better at it than me. Yeah. You ready? I'm ready. You ready?
Sure.
Okay. Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, there's a like you dare to dream really do come true. Someday I'll wish upon a star, wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where troubles melt like lemon drops high above the chimney tops. That's where you'll find. That you're flying in any more Cessnas, though, we're gonna have a problem.
Thank you. I love you too.
Wow. Thrilling. New York City debuts in real time. Wow. Now, I can't continue one moment longer without acknowledging the insane talent on this stage with me. On bass, we have Yuka Tadano. The literal dream goddess. How lucky am I? On strings, we have Chris Peters. Tunes and plays guitars. He tunes and plays them. On the keys, we have the love of my life. I love you, Colby. The love of my life. Madeline Benson. And I'm just so stupidly lucky to have two of the greatest voices in the world, right over here. We've got Mia Pack. And Esteban Suero. Honestly, if y'all just want to take over and do the rest of the night, I'm good. Okay. So I think something that's interesting about the three of us is that we have a very common interest.
What's
with
that?
Spooky things.
True.
Yes.
We keep things spooky. But like a fun spooky, not like a weird spooky. It's like a cool spooky.
Not devil cult.
No, why can't I bring the devil into it? This isn't, no.
Okay.
Cool spooky.
My bad.
We should probably just sing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ooh. Ooh. Witchy woman. See how high she flies. Street is that her apples are delicious. The jury said she's charming, but her exes say she's wicked. I swear to God, I saw her howling at the sky. She ain't out to get you, but she's better on your side. She don't wanna be anybody else.
She's a woman in total control of herself.
It spells witch, get it? It's such a wonder to be under her spell.
What a woman in total control of herself.
Like
Tinkerbell through the night. Wouldn't you love to love her? Takes to the sky like a bird in flight. Who will be her lover?
I'm a lucky girl. Oh. Well, she slid down the hall in her socks and yelled, "Come outside." No, 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 nothing's wrong. I just happened to have a surprise. So we fell through the door like the autumn leaves, and I wrestled my brother down to his knees. Just to watch as her rocket shot into the October sky. There's a picture of us in a layer of dust on the mantle right by my cigarettes that I smoked since you left, 'cause you said you had to fly. In your October sky, la da 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 da. Now I work in the city and I blend, oh, I blend into the crowd. And the people grieve with me since the towers came down. Of us hidden in a layer of dust. you may have sussed out when my dad was up here, I have a complicated relationship with flying. It scares the hell out of me. It really does. And, okay, you know when you've had bad chicken and it gives you food poisoning, right? That's me with flying. Like, flying is just kind of like a series of bad chicken dishes one after the other. And it just, it fucks me up. I'm up on the airplane, nearer my God to thee. I start making a deal, inspired by gravity. If I did wrong, I won't do it again, 'cause I can be sweet and good and nice. And if I had enemies, they're friends. I hold on to my life with the grip of a vice. So the first time I fly, I am 14 years old, and I am with my high school chorus. We are going to a choral competition in San Antonio. We won nothing. But the award ceremony was at the Six Flags out there, and I did win a 10-foot-long plush snake at the Whack-A-Mole. I take that as a win. So it was actually two flights in one day, which was not great for my emotional well-being, but I did it like a big girl. So we first flew into Houston. It was a weird day. I almost lost my coat. My boarding pass fell out of my bag, and this really creepy guy found me out of the group of like 80 high schoolers and was like, "Are you Allie?" And I was like, yeah. But it was my boarding pass. So it was like, it was weird. It was very weird. So we're in Houston. We're on the second plane with the connecting flight to San Antonio. And it's taxiing for a very long time. Taxiing is a little airplane lingo. You're welcome. Yes. So it's taxiing, and it's taking a very long time. And I can't tell you how I know that it's taking a long time, because I've only flown one other time in my life, and it was 3 hours prior. But it's taking a long time, and then I feel the plane turn. And then the captain comes on and says, "Ladies and gentlemen, in the 15 years I've been flying, I've never had to make an announcement like this," which is not something that you want to hear a pilot say. I don't want to be on the plane when it's your first time dealing with a crisis, captain. Do you know what I mean? Anyway, so he continues and says, "The pilot behind us noticed that there was something spewing from our engine, so we're going to return to the terminal to see what's up." I want all of you to think of a time in your life when the word spewing was used in a positive context. That's right, you can't, because it doesn't exist. So we're back at the terminal, and by this point I am hyperventilating. I am trying not to hysterically cry because I am surrounded by my peers who just love to be that way in high school. And I'm trying to keep it together, but it's not going well. I'm starting to cry, but it's that silent kind of crying where you're trying to keep it in, and then it's worse because you're trying to bottle it down, and it's just like a piece of, what is it, Mentos and a Diet Coke thing. It's not going well inside of me. It's not going well. But I'm sitting next to one of our chaperones, Mrs. Bonk, who was lovely. She was trying to calm me down, but I was inconsolable, and I just needed to talk to my mom. I needed to hear my mom's voice. And mom, again, I want to apologize for what I did to you on this night, because it was awful, and I know that now. I see that now as an adult. But I needed to talk to my mom, and so Mrs. Bonk flags down the flight attendant and says, "Can this inconsolable child call her mom?" And this was back in 2004, where it was kind of understood that if you even had a phone on a plane, the plane might blow up. So I was like, "We can't call her." And they were like, "No, it's fine. We're on the ground. You can call her." So I call my mom. And again, I'm sorry, Mom. The first words out of my mouth were, "Mom, I'm on the plane. There's something wrong with the engine." Which is not an inaccurate statement. It just was not the whole statement. And then she starts screaming. Because I think she thinks I'm up in the air. And like my whole life is flashing before her eyes. And then Mrs. Bonk gets on the phone and tells her that we are, in fact, on the ground. It's okay. And I think I black out for the rest of that ride. I don't know how we got to San Antonio, but I do remember very clearly walking off the plane, and the flight attendant who was helping me out had those little wings that they give to like 3-year-olds for being so brave. And she was like, "Sweetie, I wanted to give these to you for being so brave." And I looked her dead in the face and I said, "I don't deserve them." butterflies, 2 years later, I'm back with my chorus going to another concert in Ireland this time. So transatlantic, look out, buddy. We have upgraded from cross country to transatlantic. Woo! And I get on the plane and I have like a Sudoku book to keep me preoccupied. I have a Nesquik because dairy on a transatlantic flight seems like a great idea. And I get to my seat, and Mrs. Bonk is there again. She's my seatmate. It's alphabetical. She was my partner in crime. And she had the aisle seat, and I had the window seat. And she says, Allie, I think we should switch. I think I should take the window, and you should take the aisle. And I was like, why? And she's like, well, last time, sweetie, you didn't do so good. And I was like, I was fine. I was fine. And she was like, yeah, you weren't. I think we should switch. So we switch, which doesn't really make a lot of sense to me because being 3 feet to the left is not going to make me forget that I am suspended 250,000 feet up in the air. Do you know what I mean? But we switch, and then 3 hours later, I look over, and this bitch is fucking nestled up against this window like it's a little sleep pod, right? She's got a pillow and a blanket. She's all cozy. Meanwhile, my lanky ass is having her elbow and shin hit with the fucking drink cart all the way across the ocean. The entire ocean. That little spot on the ground is my hometown. I like to call it my home and it's sweet. I'd rather take a seat down there than thrown up here, up above 30,000 feet. The craziest shit that has ever happened to me while flying happened while my beautiful husband Colby and I we're on our way to our honeymoon. So where I am a nervous flyer, Colby is a little bit worse than me. I love you, it's true. So our flight was, I think, at 10:30. So naturally, we got to the airport at 5:30 that morning. We just like to be there to scope it out. I wanna know what the vibe is. I wanna feel the energy of the port. You know what I mean? I wanna like get in there. So we're there at 5:30, we have breakfast, I have coloring books and things to keep me calm, and then our flight is delayed. And then it's delayed again and again and again and again, and now it's about 12:45. Plane finally gets there, they get us on really, really quickly. The pilot says, we're gonna fuel up as quickly as possible and we'll get you out of here. So I'm sitting there, you know, I've read the safety manual twice in both English and Espanol. And I'm feeling prepared, I know where the emergency exits are, I'm feeling good. And then the pilot comes on again and says, ladies and gentlemen, in the 25 years I've been flying, I've never had to make an announcement like this, which as we learned in Houston is not something you want to hear on a plane. He continues and he says, in our haste to fuel, the fueling truck has hit the plane. Yeah, I got in a car accident on a plane. That's right. And, he continues and says, we're really sorry about this. We wanted to get you out of here, and now we don't know if we need to get a new plane or if we can fix this plane, which is a wild concept to me that he's even thinking about fixing this plane that just got in a fucking hit and run. So we get off the plane. I'm in the terminal, and I'm on my phone. I'm on, like, Kayak and Expedia because we're going to the Caribbean. So apart from renting a pontoon boat, there are only so many ways that one can get there. So I'm looking at these sites and circling back to my husband being a nervous flyer. He has these beautiful little pills that take the edge off, but he has to time it right. Otherwise, it doesn't work, right? But because we were so delayed, he was about 7 or 8 pills in at this point. And it's good because I know that they work because when the pilot said that our plane was hit by the fueling truck, unfazed. He was like, huh, weird. And I was like, what? It was like Invasion of the Body Snatchers. It was very strange. So we're in the terminal. I'm on my phone. I'm trying to keep calm. I'm trying to make sure he's hydrating because he's feeling no pain. And he very calmly says, there are men in the plane. And I'm like, yeah, babe, there are men in all the planes. They're doing their thing. And then, like children of the corn, he points and he says, no, there are men in the plane. And then I look up from my phone and I see The nose of our plane has been lifted from the rest of the plane, held together by what I assume is one hinge, and it's lifted, and I see three pairs of legs underneath it, and then I see the dent caused by the fueling truck, and I see it pop out, someone goes like this, and then we get back on the plane and fly to the fucking Caribbean. Never should have read my horoscope or the fortune on a bubblegum strip. Saying what you think won't happen will great thing to read before a trip. On an airplane, on an airplane, on an so many more stories, but there's not enough time tonight. There's not enough filler in that song, but it's bad. It's bad. Chris, why don't you come on up here? Yeah. How's everyone doing? Everyone has food, drinks, everyone's happy? There's a man who's been out sailing in a decade full of dreams, and he takes her to a schooner, and he treats her like a queen, bearing beads from California with their amber stones and greens. He's called her from the harbor, he has kissed her with his freedom. He has heard her off to starboard in the breaking and the breathing of a water weed. While she was somewhere being free, there's a man who's climbed a mountain and he's calling out her name, and he hopes her heart can hear. 3,000 miles, he calls again. He can think her there beside him. He can miss her just the same. He has missed her in the forest where he showed her all the flowers, and the branches sang a chorus as he climbed the scaly towers of a forest. The day they said goodbye, he writes,
I wish you were beside me.
We can make it if we try. He's seen her at the office with her name on all his papers. Through the sharing of the prophets, he will find it hard to shake her from his memory. There's a lady
in the city, and she thinks she loves them all. There's the one who's thinking of her. There's the one who sometimes calls. There's the one who writes her letters with his facts and figures scrawled. She's brought them to her senses. They've laughed inside her laughter. Now she rallies her defenses, for she fears that one will ask her for eternity. And she was somewhere being free. There's a man who sends her medals. He's bleeding from the war. There's a jouster and a jester and a man who owns a store. There's a drummer and a dreamer. And you know, there may be more. She will love them when she sees them. They will lose her if they follow. And she only means to please them. And her heart is full and hollow like a cactus tree. And she's so busy being free, like a cactus tree.
Next one is a song by my buddy Zach Zadek from his incredible musical, Deathless. Yeah. As a kid, maybe six or so, Mom would say, "Hey, Sam, let's go and take me for a day out on the playground. Hide and seek till the sun went away. Dad would come home and even he would play. And you were born and Mom just wasn't around. We were friends and we were fine. We hung out every day. But I got a little older and I'd stare at you and wish I was up. Up, up and away, running up and away. Dreamt I was out of there. No sister in my way. I was up, up, up and away, flying up and away. I could go anywhere. All alone, just how I wanted to be. At you, you know, guess what? Dreams do come true. Left college in Kansas City together, Abu Dhabi to Tokyo. I pop the pill because everybody knows I want to travel around the world forever. You texted every birthday, you waited every spring. I was far too far for cell phones. There was far too much to see. I was up, up, up and away, soaring up and away. Finally, I was out of there. Nobody in my way. I was up, up, up and away, running up and away. I could go anywhere. All alone, just how I wanted to be. The time changed. sick in a year or so. Dad would say, Sam, come on home. Be there for your mother and your sister. She got bad, so bad real fast. I'd say tomorrow, but the time had passed. And seeing you, it just makes me miss her. So I went up, up, up and away. Flew right up and away. Got myself out of there. I hate myself every day. I went up, up, up and away. Soaring up and away. Now when I look at you, from the theme of our evening for a moment, if you'll indulge me. Because something happened last month, and it kind of, I don't know, you know those moments where something happens and it just sort of takes your breath away in a way that you can't really process fully? And I knew I was doing this show, and I think one of the beautiful things about being an artist is that you can sort of process complex emotions through your art. And I thought it might be fun to unpack some of these feelings tonight. I am, of course, talking about the re-release of Titanic in theaters for the 25th anniversary. For those of you, hey, Shayna, yeah, baby, hey, girl, yeah, I will never let go of you. Yeah, it's for those of you who don't know me, it's my favorite movie of all time. I saw it 7 times in theaters when it first came out, which means that I had to coerce 7 different adults to take me to see it. And I did, it worked, I saw it 7 times. So when it was releasing again, I had a very short window of time because I was starting rehearsals for Spelling Bee, which is happening out in New Jersey right now. Come spell with us, it's been a hoot and a holler. But I had a limited window of time that I could see it, so I saw it twice in a 24-hour span. And it was, it was a balm to the soul. I, like, my God. My Instagram algorithm is just Titanic now, and honestly, I'm not mad at it. So I wanted to celebrate that a little bit tonight, but I didn't want to do it alone. So please, welcome to the stage, Nikki M. James and Alicia Umphress. Relationship with Titanic. What's your relationship with the film? You're taking too long. What is your relationship with the film, Nikki?
In the Milburn, movie theater, which I don't know what it was called. It was just a single theater because I'm older than you by a couple of years, so we didn't have multiplexes in the day. At the end of the movie, I felt the need to kiss the screen, and so I ran to the front and like tried to jump up and tore it. I can't believe
I've known you this long and I'm just hearing this story.
I wasn't alone. I had accomplices. Yeah.
I can understand the impulse, yeah.
It's the Leo of it all.
I mean, it's, yeah. And the Victor Garber, if we can be real. Don't you dare shame me at my own show. Let me have my silver fox.
He still could get it.
Yeah, absolutely. Alicia?
I mean, I remember, like, we had, in where I grew up, we had a dome theater that sat, like, I don't know, thousands. It was a humongous, I mean, I remember very clearly standing in line for it. But we texted about it, but recently I also went to the screening of the release in 3D. And I took a weed gummy, which was a mistake, because I forgot that the first half of that movie is a delight, and the second half is just a slow walk to the grave. I was like, so anxious the whole time. I was like, this is terrible. We were the only ones in the theater. It was like a Thursday afternoon. It's great though. God, wow.
this. What a gift.
What a gift.
What a gift.
This is the second time they've done a re-release, right?
Well, they did one for the 15th as well. Yes, Heather, yes. They did one for the 15 year, and I think I saw that one.
Yeah, I saw that one as well.
Yeah.
That's when they added the extra people falling off the side.
I think so, yeah. They beefed up the gore.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
There was also,
I think they beefed up the sound too, because this time when the guy jumps and hits the propeller, there was a very clear like doom, doom, that like I'd never heard before. It made me audibly gasp in the theater. Anyway. Thanks for making my dream come true tonight. You too.
Oh, yeah.
Swap it.
Just because of the...
Yeah. Live
I just want to make sure you're hearing yourself.
We got you.
Heck yeah. Sound checked on different mics.
Okay. Great. You ready? Okay. That's right. Ooh, ooh, ooh,
go.
It's like, what is life? What even is it? Oh, my God. Well, that'll carry me through to my deathbed. Fantastic. So I suppose we should talk about my fear of low heights. I know it's eating at all of you. So a low height is not a high height. A low height is a low height, first and foremost. And it's not really something that can be quantified, but if I had to give it an arbitrary number, I would say that a low height is a height that exists somewhere between 6 and 72 inches. Now, what does that mean? A curb, low height. A chair that you stand on to fix a bulb, low height. This stage is a low height. These shoes are honestly probably a low height. It's a height that I can and will fall from. And unlike a high height, where if I fall from a high height, I'm probably, one of two things are gonna happen. I'm either gonna die, in which case I already sang My Heart Will Go On with them, so I'm good. Or I'll be knocked out and I'm like in a coma, in which case like I can deal with that. It's fine, I'm okay with a coma. But a low height is a height that I'm gonna fall from and it's gonna hurt and I am gonna be awake and conscious for the whole thing. And it happens all the time. It's my life is one long low height. I mean like, a stair. The lowest height. The lowest height is a stair. And it affects my professional life too. And the first time, it does. It does. But I'm a big girl and I power through, but it does affect my professional life. But the first time that I realized that this was gonna be a problem, I was doing a production of Myths and Hymns off Broadway, and it was this beautiful reimagined version of it. The songs were all reordered. There was like a storyline and an arc through it where there wasn't one before. And it was set in an attic of this woman's house, and she was moving. And every box that she opened was a song. It was like a memory. But to make it interesting, they had some boxes that were rigged, that were those like little black boxes that you see in most sad high school black box productions, you know, so you could step up on them. And like, y'all, when I tell you they had me up and down on these boxes the whole time, and I was like, can I just push it and be like emotionally invested in the pushing of the box? And they were like, no, you have to get up and down. And I was like, okay, fine. It was terrifying, but the worst part of it was that I had my song that I sang in this show was like the huge emotional penultimate number where she's having all of these epiphanies and she's like, epiphanies. You heard me, Saunders. You heard me. She's having all these revelations. I'm a writer, I can give you as many words as you want, baby. She's having all these revelations and I am singing behind her, and at the crux of the song, my director was like, okay, so at this point we want you to stand up on the box. And I was like, no. But I was like 21 at the time and I didn't know that I could like advocate for myself and my fears. And I would say that it was a learning opportunity, but it wasn't. I was shitting my pants every night at that point. So I would love the opportunity to sing this song for you tonight with both feet planted firmly on the ground.
But can we fly?
whispered prayer can only pray to travel there. But all as one, we sound the everlasting sound and sing our salvation alone.
Don't.
Okay, good night. Thank you very much. I have one more for you. And this is a song that was written for tonight by the incredible Jay Adana. Yeah! Show some love to Jay, who I think is watching somewhere. Hi, Jay. I just want to take a few moments to thank Marky, Steven, and Jeanann for running this shindig tonight. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. To my incredible band, Jesus Christ. Esty and Mia, my God. To everybody working the pub tonight, thank you so much. Tip your servers exorbitantly. This is My Heart Knows How to Fly.
Eight years old, I was looking at the sky, sure that I belonged up high, reaching sticky hands to fly. Close my eyes, it seemed natural to me, the movement, the trajectory, clearer than a memory. 'Cause what could be easier, simple and true? I'm jumping right off the roof. Spread these arms, hear the wind roar, not falling. I'm gonna soar just like before and taste the sky. My heart knew how to fly. Years drift. Focus on my path. I'm doing all the math. I keep landing on my ass. Still, I see how we look from way up there. Feel my body cut the air. I've been there before, I swear. In my head, it's easier. Push off the ground, I'm soaring, not coming down. Next time it's magical, or I promise I'm meant to soar just like before and taste the sky. My heart knows how to fly. Time slips and I'm in a hole now, dug down to feel some control. How did I end up grounded, grounded, grounded so deep? I'm drowning, drowning, drowning. Is it a curse? Is it a joke? Why can I imagine flight? Now old, thought I was supposed to fly. Is it time to say goodbye? One last time I search the sky, and though I see less of it, storm clouds recede. That sliver's all that I need. Remember, flight yet to be.
This song is incredibly special to me for many reasons, but mostly because my dear friend Nico Benson wrote this. And anytime I get to sing it, it's just the honor of my life. So thank you, Nico. When the sun sets, instead of sleeping, my eyes focus on the moon. The silver glow of mystery suspended there up in the air, compelling me, telling me to try to fly beyond all the trees. Yes, all the way up to the moon. Go, wave to the ants on the ground. No, upward and never look down. Breathe, flap till I can't anymore. Reach for the glow. Yeah, so maybe I'll never touch the moon. But boy, did I soar. And isn't that what my wings are for? Thank you all very much. Have a good night.